How do we get people to care about civic issues, about the city that we all live in? We were seeing two trends. One is that, you know, Bandra people seem to care about Bandra, Powai people care about Powai, South Bombay people care about South Bombay, people who live in RA care about RA and so on, but there doesn't seem to be a collective caring about the city as a whole and the context that we all live in. That's one. And the second is that a lot of this caring seems to happen online. For example, the scroll video on RA has got 1.2 million views, but when people ask to come up or to assemble on the ground, that doesn't happen as much as it should. So how do we get people to care about something that really affects all of us? And this is a question that's to all of you.
That's a huge question. Thanks for that, Parmesh. That's really massive because there are multiple aspects to this question and therefore the answer where, how do you get people to care? I mean, I basically think that, you know, it just goes to the very basic tenets of education. And that becomes an enormous question at the primary level, at the secondary level, at the undergrad level and the postgrad level for whoever gets there. And then all the debates that were happening with regard to education in our country these days, and you know how textbooks are being changed and so on, and all of that comes together. And to a larger environment where you are able to talk about things without being branded a certain way or another way and so on. Because I think, you know, as we were discussing outside, where the entire fact, and you said that environmentalists are usually taken as people who put the brakes on progress, this idea of somebody's progress and so on. All of that ties in, you know, really all of that ties in. And where do you start? You start with having a free and fair education to start, you know, and what else? I mean, you know, let's say I'm a film professional. I have one finger in education and, you know, film programming and so on. You do what you can to the best of your ability in the field where you work. And so depending on whatever field we all work in, it might be different. And, but you know, you go about it with a sense of, like you said, you know, wanting to reach out and wanting to get people together about whatever the subject of, you know, that you may want to talk about at that point of time. So you want to comment?
Yeah, that seems like very long term. I wonder if you all have short term, because by the time we change the education system and go through that process, how much will we have lost out?
No, I mean, I think, you know, the way systematically it has to happen, it really has to happen. And the way, you know, if you are talking about these larger systems that are put into place over decades and decades and generations and so on, and of course there are flaws there, but if there is a systematic program of doing things which are actually not good for you in the long term, you know, that is something that has to be addressed right away, you know. So, yeah.
What's that?
No, I think it's a difficult question because it's I mean, if how do we learn how to care? I think the most important thing is also for us, I mean, also looking at this wonderful film, is to begin to understand the city a little better. I think what has happened is we have forgotten how the city really works. I mean, take the question of slums, for instance. I think if you look at the history of the term itself, the slum discourse and how it came about, even before independence, the term slum, and even in our law, even in even on paper, the idea of the slum is a settlement which is dilapidated, which is obsolescent, which is, fails to comply with planning norms. You know, those are the ways in which a slum is understood. Overcrowded
illegal.
Settlement.
Illegal.
No, that no, no. So that's the trick, right? So all of the way in which slums, the way in which slums were understood, was almost entirely a conditional understanding of a settlement, and. So initially, when the BMC first time it did its slum survey, it was the what we today call dilapidated cess buildings. Those were considered slums. Chawls were considered slums. Temporary accommodations were considered slums. Informal settlements were considered slums, but, and you know, so the idea of a slum was a condition. The idea of slum being an illegal settlement comes in the 80s. And it's a very interesting shift. It is not, it's a time when the World Bank is coming in. It is talking about providing 10-year security to slums. If you look at the Slum Act, Slum Areas Improvement Rehabilitation Act, there is no mention of property. There's no mention of the word encroachment is not used. This happens much later. And today, when we speak about slums, we generally speak about the term encroachment, illegal settlements. So this move from condition assessment to the idea of illegality reflects the general trend in urban development. And I think that is one of the problems. Now, coming back to the question, I think when we start understanding what an informal settlement is, what these auto-constructed neighborhoods are about, we realize that these are very much part of the working class neighborhoods in the city. And how can a city exist without its working people? That is the, I think, when we begin to understand the dynamic of the urban, I think we would have gone a long way in whatever follows from there.
So I have a slightly different view. I think people do care, but mostly people care about the things which are close to them. And it's people like us who tend to care about maybe slightly wider issues to bring those people on board by making it about them. I think that's the trick, that if you talk about, say, slums, people will care about the person they know. They will care about the woman who works in their house, their cook, their driver. They do care about those things. And I think we need to make it personal for everybody. So for my own experience has been that if you talk about a subject like environment, say noise pollution, nobody cares about noise pollution as a broad subject because it's too difficult to tackle. And that's exactly why nobody had cared until I started. But people definitely care when they're blasted with noise near their own house. They want to know how to complain. They want to know what to do. And they will make that one complaint if they won't take up a wider subject. And then, of course, we're lucky to have a few people always there who want to take it up on a wider scale. So the trick is to tap into them as well. But I think the very first thing we have to do as people who in some way are leading subjects of various kinds in our own fields is to identify the people who will become future leaders and let them lead subjects of their choice. They don't necessarily lead the subject you tell them to lead, because as leaders, they have their own wishes, their own viewpoints, and you want to encourage that. So that's one. And the others is people who don't have time, normal people who have a work day life. You have to engage them as well and let them do what they can do. So even school kids have a necessity. They have to have school projects. We know that we can tap into this thing and make them interested. If 100 school children do a project, maybe 3 will become interested and become future leaders. So I look at it that way, that people do care. It's just that we have to figure out how to connect them with their caring, with the subjects which need caring. And so that's the way I would look at it.
So if I can ask a follow-up question, you mentioned about the noise pollution campaign. A lot of people who work on these issues, say such as you, whether environment or others, are often considered as pesky obstacles to growth by the government. And by, in general, it's like Mukul mentioned earlier as well, alluding to a conversation we had earlier, oh, these environmentalists have come and they're going to stop growth, they're going to stop progress. How do you deal with that bias as well as engage, because you have to engage with government, civic authorities, etc., to push for the kind of change that you want? If you can give us some examples of success where you've managed to do that.
Well, you know, the government is people too. And they have various different levels at which they operate. One is their political agenda, which is what you're referring to. But we have to also remember that it's comprised of people, and they face the same issues as we do. So again, it's a matter of tapping into the people and figuring out where they can collaborate with you and where they can't. Where they can't, because sometimes their political expediency takes over and they can't. In which case, there are other people and you have to counter it by showing them that there are numbers there which matter. And that has worked at various times. But I find very often that even when they're taking what I consider a very unreasonable stand, they know that. They're well aware that their stand is unreasonable. And somewhere you can always make sure that they understand that, not only understand that, but they appreciate that what you're saying is right. Whether they do it or they don't do it is actually a separate matter, because it's again at so many levels. But they do appreciate. I have never had, and I have never been personal. I think I've been very careful not to be personal about people, because I feel that everybody is entitled to their viewpoint. Some agree with me, some vehemently disagree with me, many fall somewhere in the middle. And it's up to me to convince people, even those who are against me. And since you asked me for a story, I'll tell you an interesting one. One of the very first orders, court orders on noise pollution was in 2003. And it happened just after Ganpati and just before Navratri, when the police were told not to allow any loudspeaker permissions in silent zones. That was the first time that a silent zone was actually made anything worth even talking about. So I was very skeptical. I thought this can never happen. And a journalist published my number in one of the papers on the front page. So many people started calling me almost continuously. And of course, I had no idea what to do, because people were calling me, but what can you really do? So the only answer I had was call 100, which is the police number. But of course, it worked very well, because the police, when they started getting hundreds of calls only on one subject, and they had everybody say the same thing, which was that there's a court order and stop this noise, then they were forced to take action. That's one. The second is that I, of course, assumed that the Navratri mandals are going to be very upset with me. But strangely enough, not only did noise almost completely stop in silent zones, in fact, I had nothing to measure, I was so shocked, except these calls which I was getting, which were mainly in housing societies. But one of the leading Navratri mandal heads called me after Navratri and said, "Madam, we don't agree on many things, but my daughter is doing a college project. Can you help her do a project on noise pollution?" And that really shocked me, because it made me realize that, after all, they understand what you're saying. They know what you're saying. They know that you're not against them. You're against a subject.
Thank you for sharing that. There is a severe need for affordable housing in the city. There are developers. The pleasurable irony of sitting in the middle of a building like Godrej One, in which there's development happening outside, doesn't escape me. I hope it doesn't escape anyone else as well. As we're having this conversation, there are builders. There is a need. How do we bring all these different stakeholders together? There are people who live in informal settlements.
So I just feel that what would really be desirable, is we're talking about it becomes important to remember and also really push for, you know, the government actually to provide, you know, whether it's through the PPP arrangement or on its own as it used to do earlier, to provide affordable housing, which is a mandate that it completely threw away. You know, when liberalization happened, then they said, okay, now you are a customer, you're not so much a citizen as you used to be. So now you deal with, because we don't have the resources to provide each one of you housing. We know that we have semi-legalized you in the places where you live over a period of time. Now we want you removed from here because maybe it's illegal sometimes. Again, you know, that's a complicated thing. How do you define what is illegal? Or we need this land because suddenly it's in the middle of the city. It used to be outside the city 20 years ago, but now it's next to the airport and we want it because it's, you know, and you're suddenly a security hazard and safety hazard and so on. So, but we can't give you housing, sorry, you know, please go. And if there is a certain sense of a minimum standard that has to be maintained, you know, with regard to the facilities that you're provided in terms of the size of the houses, or just the basic width of a corridor, width of a staircase, distance between buildings. You see just nearby here in Lalubai compound in Mankot, or all the development that's happened in Mankot, where the buildings are 10 feet away from each other. So there can never be the light and ventilation that is required for people, you know, to live. And it has led to, and this is something that people are studying, and all this is being implemented, you know, knowing fully well that this is a problem. But you're going ahead and implementing it, and there are health problems, there are mental health problems, and again, the entire problem of displacing people from close to their place of employment, you know, and what happens to you, which again, the film talks about. So I just feel that the government can't wash its hands off that easily. So it's, I don't know, I mean, it's something that others might disagree on, but if you are getting private parties involved, there's a certain basic minimum standard that has to be maintained, you know, is what I feel, which is where earlier as a socialist state, you were mandated to provide for the citizen, but at some point you said, now it's you and the private sector, deal with it, you know, and that's a problem, that's clearly a problem.
Hussain, if you can follow up on that, because given that this is a reality, how does architecture intervene? How do your students and then the architects you train, how do they intervene in either creating the kind of just basic minimum housing that Mukul is talking about, or in other ways in helping change mindsets?
So Mukul brought up a few, lots of things, just to pick up on some of them. One of the things that he did mention was liberalization and how things changed after that. Very interestingly, what's really happening is at the moment of liberalization, there is a new way of thinking about there's sort of a recalibration of the role of the state. It's called the enabling market strategy, where the state moves from the state is supposed to not really intervene in land and housing markets, but facilitate them, in fact, create land and housing markets, actively promote the creation of land and housing markets. And now the way it plays out in Bombay's unique development story is that now the state fulfills its electoral promises by providing incentives to developers. SR is a classic outcome of this. If we remember, if we go back to 95, and it was a Baltakre's election promise that I will provide 4 million free houses to slum dwellers. That was an electoral promise. How does that happen? Well, the state has to not spend its financial resources. The way it will happen is by unlocking land values. That's where the private developer comes in. Now, this process of capitalizing the value of land to create housing, not necessarily for the slum dwellers. We must remember that the SRA is not a housing policy. It's a financial instrument to convert land which is occupied by dwellers and to release it into the market for housing and large and most importantly, middle and upper income housing. So going back a little, one realizes that in post-independence India, there was the state could not build housing for all its working people. For instance, in Bombay, the housing demand annually was 50,000 units, but the state cooperative housing and the other agencies, you know, employer housing, they were not producing more than 20,000 units. There was a huge deficit of housing production, which resulted in the creation of informal settlements, people building for themselves. Now what happens, and so what you find is informal settlements started being perceived as kind of labor camps. And the state's attitude was this was a welfare state which could not provide housing, but it reluctantly allowed people to squat. Now what happens is that slums are perceived as undercapitalized public resources. And it's only through the unlocking of land values you will be able to open these lands up for other purposes. There's the concept of highest and best use. The economics of land will dictate what should be built where. This shift, again, this shift of the slum from being a labor camp to being a public resource which is undercapitalized makes the slum dweller suddenly an encroacher, somehow obstructing the world-class dream. And that is where policies like the schemes like the SRA are born. And this is really the story. So it's not really the developer, which is I mean, in Bombay, we've villainized developers enough. I'm not a fan. But the idea is, how do we understand the role of the state in the question of housing? And unless we really give this, you know, a complete rethink, I think we are going to have a problem.
So we have another plan coming up, which is being discussed right now, and I want to open our public discussion with that as well. It's the Mumbai Development Plan, which is being discussed right now. It's not being debated enough. I don't think we're being allowed to debate it enough. But there seems there's lots of caginess going on about this plan, about what it will entail, what it will take away from us. I wonder if any of you want to reflect on our prospects as citizens, not just customers in this Mumbai Development Plan, as we imagine our city's future, before we open it up to questions from the audience.
Well, as I mentioned, everybody is very interested when it comes to his own area. And I think the Mumbai Development Plan had an unprecedented number of suggestions and objections, mostly from people in their own areas. So if there is something going to happen on your street, everybody is very interested. And that's the level at which we have to keep it. Unfortunately, the government learned in inverted commas from its mistake and kept this revised version of the plan very, very low key, so that people didn't really have a chance to complain in the same way, in the same numbers. And while many of the mistakes have been corrected, and I for one did go to the hearings which were held for the development plan, but the hearings were held so late that it's difficult to really know what suggestions have been added into the plan. For example, my suggestions were all to do with the environment. They had to do with the fact that we have a tree census of this city, but the development plan doesn't have any map of trees. So we're starting as if from a clean slate and going ahead. Any trees which come in the way just happen to be in the way. So that's a very, very bad planning exercise, but that's how it is. The other thing is that we have the coastal road. I mean, Hussain knows more about the coastal road than anyone else, so I won't comment too much, except from the environmental point of view, that if you look at the BMC's own report on how the weather patterns are, you will see that there are certain seasons when the wind is carried in from the sea to the city. So to have a massively intensive air polluting activity like huge vehicular movement along the sea is going to impact the air pollution of the entire city. Plus they have certain conditions, like we will plant four times the number of mangroves. But when you build a seawall and deepen the depth of the sea, you can't plant mangroves because you're changing the environment in such a way that the mangroves cannot grow. So these are all things which are done in such a way. I mean, the people who live on Carter Road, for example, will be very concerned about the mangroves. And they should be concerned and they should be heard. And that's how the first development plan was stopped, because the Carter Road people talked about Carter Road, the Marine Drive people talked about Marine Drive, the Pali Hill people talked about Pali Hill, and there were so many of them collectively. Whereas if you ask a Pali Hill person to talk about Marine Drive, naturally his enthusiasm is limited. So that's our job. We need to get people together, get them to talk about themselves, that which impacts them. For noise pollution, again, I mean, as you know, perhaps I have a litigation in court, and the court has ordered that the government include noise pollution as part of their planning exercise for the DP. But the DP has been finalized and noise pollution has not been incorporated. And so now again, the question comes that for something like noise pollution, are you going to stop the whole DP? But they knew about this in advance. It was in order. They were supposed to do it years ago. We've been talking about a noise mapping of the city since 2004. So today to say it's too late kind of, you know, so it's a very funny situation. Again, if you don't want helicopters to be landing in the building next to you, if you do, I mean, which is part of the DP, allowing private helipads on private rooftops, if you don't want your view of Marine Drive, where you go to the sea for a walk, or Carter Road, or whichever part of the city you live in, if you don't want many things which are going to happen, don't talk of the DP as a whole. But at least talk of yourself, talk of your own area, talk of your neighborhood, talk of what you would like in the building, in the flat you live in.
Mukul and Hussain.
Okay, so since we're talking about the DP and we're in Godrej, I thought maybe we can, I'd share a very interesting story about this. There was a legislation which came out in during the emergency. It was called the Urban Land Sealing and Regulation Act, which was after the emergency. Emergency was a very brutal period in Bombay. Lots of people were evicted and resettled in large resettlement colonies. The Urban Land Sealing Act was a classic legislation which was quasi-socialist, but it was riddled with so many loopholes that the state managed to acquire very little land, if at all. The idea was that the surplus land, more than 500 square meters per person, would be acquired and used for affordable housing, given to MARA to build affordable housing. I think they could not acquire more than 200 hectares of land, which is nothing in Bombay. Now, what happens is it becomes the Urban Land Sealing Act becomes a real bone of contention for many projects which come into Bombay, especially ones which are financed by international financial institutions. It's a conditionality, it has to be repealed despite its loopholes. Now, one of the ways in which developers or landowners could escape the Land Sealing Act was if your land is on a no development zone, no acquisition. If your land is industrial land, no acquisition. If your land is a natural area, no acquisition. So Godrej is an industrial land, right? The large swathes of land that are owned by Godrej were not acquired because they were industrial lands, and also some of them were no development zones. Now what happens is the Land Sealing Act gets repealed in 2007. After a lot of pressure by developers and landowners. And the new development plan starts getting prepared in 2011. So now the no development zones are gone. The zoning which the development plan would do of no development zones and the industrial land reservations, they are all gone. And so now you see many of the lands in these areas being opened up for residential and commercial developments. This is what the development plan really does to the city. In fact, suddenly you will have a lot of lands opened up for affordable housing, which means developer-built housing, which also means a lot of land again and a lot of property, middle and upper income property. So, this is the development plan story, and that is why it is so important to understand what it is going to do in the next 20 years in the city.
So, good evening. My name is Vivek, and I study at the University of Mumbai. I had two broad-based questions depending on the context of what we are discussing. My first question is that cities today are facing a lack of open spaces, whether it's RA or community gardens or public gardens or sidewalks or roads or basic transportation facilities. We are facing a lack of open spaces and access to them. Earlier, there was a nexus. We used to talk about the builder and the politician nexus. Today, the builder is the politician, and the politician is the builder. So how do we grapple through that and go forward with that from a policy perspective? That's, the second part of it. And in, the narrative of development that we've been carrying the whole baggage throughout history, what we've seen is with the proliferation of slums, we've also had proliferation of development agencies. So whether it's BMC, MARDA, SRA, MMRDA, PWD, et cetera, in terms of implementation, it becomes very complex and very difficult because every development agency has a certain space. So if a civic, if a public person, if any commoner wants to issue a complaint, whether it's road or et cetera, whether it's solid waste management, how do we, sort of from a policy perspective, again, have a comprehensive way to sort of streamline all development agencies to come together for the city? That's one aspect of it. Second, as Mona ma'am spoke about common sense, the state, forget common sense, we want to be smart. We are moving towards smart cities. So in that context, what are your thoughts on smart cities? Do you feel there is, is it for the benefit of the people? Or, like the video showed a clear distinction of, a posh building and an SRA project, a distinction of classes. So is the smart city really smart and inclusive, or is it only encouraging a certain group of people, a certain class of people who can have the capacity to access those services. So what are your thoughts on smart cities?
If you think about the development plan and what happens, what happened with that, there were two development plans, one in 2014, which was scrapped, and then there was another one. One of the reasons why the earlier development plan was scrapped was because developers were not happy with it, you know, because they didn't get enough, and this is what they themselves said. So I'm literally saying what they said. So for instance, there was a conversation I'd had with one of the developer, presidents of one of the developer groups, MCHI, if you know them. And if you want to redevelop maybe a cooperative society in the suburbs today, you get one FSI, which is the 1.33 FSI, which is the standard. Then you get one FSI as TDR, plus you can get fungible of 0.33. So you would get about 2.7 FSI. What the earlier development plan did was it capped the FSI 2.4, which is not very low, which is high, but you know, but they, so it's 0.3 less. How can we accept that? You know, I mean, so scrap the DP. Anyway, that was gone. But if you see the who has written the development control rules of the city, now it has been renamed Development Control and Promotion Regulation of Mumbai, which doesn't make any sense. How can you control and promote regulation at the same time? Anyway, they've all been written, literally drafted by PIETA, which is the Engineers and Architects Association, and developer groups. The regulators are today, there is no difference between the regulators and the regulated. They're one and the same.
I mean, there's another aspect, of course, to smartness and cities, and of course, developers and politicians, and they're all the same now. So, and that is like a demand and supply situation. We're building cities when we don't know what we're building them with. All cities, all construction takes sand or an aggregate of some kind. We don't have any mapping of aggregate in this country. We don't know how much sand is required for the projects we announce. We don't know if we substitute sand with stone, how much stone will be required. We don't know where it's coming from. We don't know anything. We only know that we look at Navi Mumbai and we see the mountains being destroyed. We look at all our beaches and see only rock left where there's no longer any sand. So I don't understand how, when even a simple household cannot run without knowing what your budget is and what you're going to produce as a result of it, how we can run a country and announce these kind of smart cities without knowing what we're building them with. So I think that's something we need to look at, quite apart from everything else about the city, that we have no resources to build with to start with.
And for all of you, I mean, who really want to make a difference, right, there are some amazing organizations out there who are doing all this mapping. So India Spend, for example, which is a data journalism initiative out of Bangalore, has done some incredible mapping, whether on pollution levels, which is helping younger people like you to take this data and then go out to your local authority and say, look, here, I mean, you know, it's higher than it was last year, and here's the reason or whatever. Likewise with everything else. So I would say don't lose, the challenges are a lot and they are significant, but there's also very resourceful stuff coming up in our country that we can use for the kind of changes that we want to bring about. Let's actually then, you know, start seeking these out, tapping into these and using them to our advantage. Yeah.
So one hopeful story. There are many. During the development plan suggestion objection process, there is a settlement in Bombay near Mankhurd, in Mankhurd, and the residents of the settlement, predominantly informal settlement, came together. People within the settlement itself, they read the plans, they got stitched them, they analyzed them. They made their own proposed development plan, on which they mapped their health facilities, education facilities, the way they want their homes to be upgraded. And this was all done by the residents of Mankhurd with the help of academic institutions, but they did it themselves. And they submitted it to the municipal corporation. And these are things that we saw during the development planning process quite a lot. The amount of engagement with the DP that has happened this time is, I think, unprecedented. The earlier development plans, a lot of people engaged with them, but they were mostly architects, engineers, you know, people who knew urban development. But this time, we find a lot of people who understand the development plan and who have engaged with it and who have also made their own alternatives.